So hi everyone. So today we are going to try to put in practice a lot of notions that you have seen with Nicolas Vaiartis on Monday for signal processing. And as a matter of fact, I'm going to put you in our position like 5 years ago when we started a collaboration with medical doctors for the study of locomotion and the study of gait. And you're going to experience with the Jupyter notebook some of the work that we have done to actually put in practice a work dedicated to the quantification of human locomotion thanks to accelerometer signals. And you will see that we will start with some basic tools from signal processing, such as the Fourier transform, the spectrogram, the autocorrelation function, etc. And then we will go to more advanced tools, for instance, change point detection, and some machine learning mixed with signal processing algorithm that will help us. And you will see how it can help you to actually extract all the relevant information from the signals. So we will do we will have some part with the slides, and then we'll have to experience things with your notebook, and then we will go back, etc. So it will be interactive in this way. So first of all, I'm going to describe the problem that you will have to solve, and it's a very difficult problem. So, but you will see some way of seeing different point of view on this signal, on this problem, that can help you to understand the methodology that we used. So the problem we are interested in, it's the gait analysis. Why do we want to study locomotion? At first, it was a collaboration with medical doctor that came to us and said, human gait is such an important topic. Why is it so? Because it's the most common dynamic human activity. So you have to walk. It's something that human beings are made to walk, and it's a very good way to reveal a large number of pathology, such as neurological pathology. If you think of the Parkinson's disease, for instance, people who have strokes, their gait is going to be affected by that. There's a lot of orthopedic pathology, like if you break your leg, then your gait is going to be affected as well. And some rheumatological disorder, etc., etc. So actually studying the gait, it's a best way to study a large panel of different diseases. And why is it important right now to study gait? Because we know that locomotion, it has a very strong influence on daily life. You probably experience in your life, or I hope you won't, but you're likely to experience, like your grandfather, grandmother, when they start to stop walking, then their life quality is going to decrease, and well, in most cases, the ending is not very good. There's a lot risk of falling that can be dangerous. People become frail. They lost their autonomy as well, and they become dependent. And it's a very big topic when we speak about like how to deal with elderly people, like. How do we care, and how do we evaluate the situation of elderly people? So gait, this is why we were interested in studying that. But how can we study locomotion? There are mainly two ways of doing that. With the medical doctor we were working with, the tests they used were really basic tests. It was like clinical examination. So they just look at you and they say, okay, your gait is okay or not. For instance, we worked with a neurologist, and in this unit, they used stars. Like, it was from 1 star to 5 stars. So depending on the way that you walked, you get a grade, something like that. So you can see that it's very easy to do, because the physician only has to look at you and they will give you a score, but it's not precise at all. And when you have a subject that comes like 6 months later, based only on the score that you have, it's impossible to know if the gait has improved or is not, or something happened, there was a fall, etc., and the gait is degraded. So this was one part of dealing with the problem. The second part was there are some labs dedicated to the study of locomotion. They have like a room, dedicated room with a lot of sensors everywhere, like a video optical system, like motion capture system, for instance. They have sensors in the floor of the room as well. And they can record everything. Like they put a lot of sensors on you, and they can record very precisely the way that you walk, all the muscles, etc. So the precision is great. You can extract a lot of information from that, and it's very objective. But setting up such protocol can take up to 1 or 2 hours. And we know that the health system, it's difficult. They don't have much time. It's very crowded. So it's very difficult to put in place. And it's actually never used except for clinical trials. And it's very expensive as well, because you need someone to put the sensors, etc. So we thought of a new way of recording gait. The idea was we wanted something objective, an objective quantification. So if we want that, we cannot rely only on the eye of the doctor. We need to have sensors. So we use sensors and physiological measurements. Then what we want to do is to compare different trials, because we want to compare like one subject 6 months later, for instance, and we want to be able to compare what happened in the first session and in the second session. That's called longitudinal follow-up. It means that you're following one patient a long time. The other thing that we want to do is to compare subjects. Like, for instance, if you have someone that begins whose gait is going to be degraded, maybe we want to compare it to a Parkinsonian patient in order to look if there are some similarities, and maybe it can give you help you to put a diagnosis on a disease. That's the second principle we had. So for that, we need a fixed protocol. We need that the protocol is always the same. The third point was that we didn't have the money to have a big room full of sensors, so it needs to be on the field. So we wanted to build something that was useful for any doctor, like even your médecin généraliste, general medicine, that it was easy to put in place. So we used some wireless and very small sensors that you put on the subject, and we built a fully automatic device, because we wanted that to be used in routine use. That's the third principle. Then, of course, we want some clean data. So we wanted to control everything. We wanted to control the entire measurement chain, and we wanted to build some robust algorithm. That means that an algorithm should work for healthy subjects, for Parkinson, for stroke, for multiple sclerosis, etc. We want algorithm to be robust to any kind of differences that we might see on the database. And then we want to capture the expertise of the clinician, so we wanted to record annotation as well. So we did that, and here's the protocol that we used. The protocol we used was a series of 5 different regimes. Remember that because it will help you later to set up some parameters. The first, we asked the subject to stay still and stand for 6 seconds. Then the subject walks for at 10 meters. And we don't ask him to walk fast or slow. He decides of the way that he wants to walk. It's like preferred walking speed. Then a U-turn. Then the subject goes back. And then the subject stays still for 2 seconds. So we wanted to see how the subject we had, we wanted to see how they work for real. So we didn't give us a lot of indication. It was really like, okay, walk, do U-turn and come back. So it was a simple protocol. During this protocol, we had some sensors. So this is the small sensors. The size of the sensors, it's something like, it's something like that. I don't know if you see my hand. So it's something very small. It's wireless. And we put that on the, actually on 4 different locations. But for you, you will only have the data for the foot. For the feet, actually, so you have one sensor on the right foot and one on the left foot. And we had a lot of quantity that we recorded. We had acceleration in the 3 directions, angular velocities in the 3 directions, and magnetic fields in the 3 directions as well. Since I think that in order for the tutorial, I use only univariate signal, so you will only get the angular velocity around axis Y. So if you see a foot like that, it's going to be the angular velocity around this axis. So I don't know if you see that on the slide. So it will be something like, if you have your foot like that, it will be like this. So it's a good quantity for studying locomotion, because you will see that, well, the way that your foot goes on the ground, this angular velocity actually capture all the phenomenon of interest. So you will only get angular velocity around axis Y for the left foot and for the right foot. All the data is synchronized and sample at 100 Hertz. So you will see that in the Jupyter notebook. So you will have a database of 221 recordings. So you will have some LC subjects. It's actually most of the database. So that people that have no known medical impairment. You will have some patients with orthopedic trouble. You have different kind of pathology, some kind of osteoarthrosis, some disease affecting the knee, and two diseases related to the knee. And you will have another cohort with neurological group. You have people with cerebellar disorder. It's a kind of disorder that, well, it's not a good way to say that, but it makes you walk like you're drunk. So it's really like something that they are fuzzy and they tend to have. It's difficult for them to be still and to have a good equilibrium. I don't know the word, but I think you get that balance. It's difficult for them to have a good balance. And we have people that that had a brain cancer, and we removed some part of the brain, and they had very aggressive chemotherapy. And from that, they get some very their gait is really degraded from that. And so the first part of the tutorial, it's the very first part of any project in signal processing. You will look at the signals. And I have put here some example. So what do you see here? You have LCE subject, someone with a moderate pathology, and someone with a very severe pathology. So first of all, you're going to see a lot of signals, and we are going to discuss that together, what you've seen, etc. And then we are going to answer three main questions. First of all, you see that if you want to study locomotion, like only gait, you have a problem in this signal. Why is it so? Because you have here a period where the subject is still, then locomotion, then U-turn, then locomotion, then still. So you will need to isolate the different regime in your signals. For these signals, the first one is kind of easy. You see that it's easy to find this. But for instance, if you look at the signal for a pathological subject, then it becomes more difficult. So we will see some algorithm that can help to detect the different regime. Then, what we're interested in, if you want to work on locomotion, is the notion of gait. You know that you can record and to count the steps. You are interested in seeing the length of a step, the duration of a step, etc. These steps manifest as small pattern that you can see here. You have a small pattern, this has the steps, and we are going to see, is it possible to extract these steps automatically from a signals? That's called convolutional dictionary learning. It's something that you have seen with Nicolas, I think, and we will see that together. And then you're going to use both this algorithm to compute your own device for extracting relevant features for longitudinal follow-up and inter-individual comparison. The aim is based on one recording to extract like something like one or two features of interest that can then help you to see if the gait is a good quality or not, if the patient is likely to be a pathological patient or not, etc., etc. So this is what we are going to do today. So the first part is going to be like maybe 15 minutes of you looking at different signals. So we will switch on the notebook. So I will partager mon écran. Alors, hop. Okay. So I don't know if you see my my screen here.
Yes, it's okay.
Okay. So you have here, you have a big text on that you can read that describe the different kind of disease and what we want to extract and what was the context of our study. Then you have some words on the data, and I've put here it's in a database, and I put here the different indexes for the different diseases. So if you want to see someone that has a knee problem, then you can see recording this one or this one, for instance. I have a quick description on the protocol and some signals, and then you will simply have. So you have. You will simply have to. So you can load the database, and then you can choose a recording, and you will display the age of the subject, the kind of pathology the subject has, the duration of the recording, and then you can plot the signals for the left foot and right foot. And you're going to spend like 10 minutes or 15 minutes just to do that. You will see different subjects, different pathology, and the idea is that we are going to discuss that together. What do you observe? What difference can you see between healthy and pathological subjects? And how can you interpret the different phase in the protocol? So that's going to be the first part of the tutorials. And then we will see some signal processing tool to perform that, to mine a little bit and to represent the different signals.
Laurent?
Yes.
Yes. Oui. Just a question. We have some deprecated function with matplotlib. It is just a question of version. It's just warning, it's not error.
Ah, okay.
So,
Et ça revient sur le spectrogramme. Le spectrogramme plusieurs fois, comme il est beaucoup utilisé.
Donc c'est quoi qui... So, it seems that it is shading equal flat. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe it is just a question of version of... I don't know if other people... just tell me if you... Yes. I can see several warning messages with matplotlib. I don't know.
If it's just a warning, it's still okay, I think.
Yes, yes.
But...
you know, it was just to have a perfect...
yeah. Okay, so maybe now we can discuss what you've seen. So you do the talking.
Yes, we still have some problem of installation on some computer. We don't know why. Okay. Ruptor is not recognized either with Conda or PIP, so it's strange. So we are trying to solve some problem.
Okay.
So Clément is asking if you are using Python 3.9. Yes, the answer is yes, Clément.
Yes, I know that it's for some function in Rupture, you need to have 3.8.
Ah.
I know that some are working, but maybe not this one.
Maybe some.
Yes.
So in fact, she just restart Anaconda and now it is working.
Ah, okay.
And Clément, do you still have the problem? PyFestina has no width. Okay. So Laurent, do you want someone shared his screen to show you what he obtained, or I don't, and you comment? I don't know how you want to proceed now.
Maybe they can just comment what. Maybe I don't know what. If you have seen a signal that is interesting, maybe we can all run it to. I don't know what are your observations.
Yes. So for people online. If you have comments or if you want to share your screen and to discuss about the shape of the signal you are observing, just feel free to chat or to share your screen. So Philippe is giving some insight on the chat.
Yes, it's a good observation.
Laurent, for people with arthrosis, the recordings are shorter now because I observed also that pathological recordings are sometimes much longer, but I think arthrosis pathology, they seem very
I think it depends because for instance, if you have the knee arthrosis like 122, it's the longest signal in the database.
Okay.
So it really depends on the type of on the severity of the disease. One of the main outcome of this is that only based on the pathology, it's very difficult to know if you expect something with low amplitude or large amplitude or a long signal or short signals, because actually there's a very important feature that you do not have here. It's the severity of the disease. And for instance, arthrosis, it can just be like a small a complication in your daily life, or it can be a real handicap. I don't know what is that in handicap. Does the word disability? No. Oh, yes. So it really depends. But there are some interesting comments in the chat. The fact that pathological recordings are much longer, it really depends, I think, depending on the recordings. But there's a trend for severe disease. It's true that you will take a long time to walk. And actually, it's one of the most used features. It's actually a feature of a clinical test that you ask someone to walk for 10 meters and come back. You record only the time. And it's only a very good feature to assess the fact that your locomotion is going to be good or bad. There's something about the regularity that was said, something less regular and less periodic. It's true that the shape of the signals are not the same. For LC subjects, you will tend to see that all the signals kind of look alike. It's always kind of the same. You really see the steps. It's very clear. For pathological subjects, it's more complicated. Amplitude, it's the same. It really depends on the severity, because if you have someone that cannot walk at all, then the steps will be very, very small, and the amplitude will be very, very, very small as well, because the velocity is not going to be very, very large. But you have some people that have difficulty to walk, and that they will, on the contrary, put their foot on the floor very, not in a smooth way, so you will get a greater amplitude. So actually, there's no good answer on this observation. The main observation is that it's complicated. There are some subjects, it's true that those with the brain and injury, it affects the symmetry of the locomotion. So they will have different signals for the left and the right foot as well. It's very true that the U-turn, it's very difficult to see when you have severe disease. Why is it so? Is it because the people, for instance, with severe Parkinson's disease, they will not perform a U-turn as such? They will just put some very small steps. You know, instead of, I don't know if you can look at my hand, instead of doing that, you know, that, they will do tac, 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 tac. So it's going to be only steps. And for those subjects, the looking, well, when you look at the time signals, it's very difficult to see, to really see where the U-turn is. So it's kind of difficult. For the different phases of the protocol, there are change of STD in the locally for at least one of the two signals. Yes, it's true, but yet for the very pathological subject, it's kind of difficult to see that. For instance, if you look at subject, subject 220. You will see that, for instance, on the right foot, it's impossible to see the U-turn. The only modification is that the pattern that represents a step, it's kind of very it's slightly different for the step during the U-turn than for the other steps. So. Actually, when we started this project, we were a bit in the same situation as you. It means we were kind of confused because it's not like if we had a rule, you know, something that you say, okay, if the amplitude is slow, then it means that someone is a pathological. If the signal is long, then it's pathological. You see that for each criteria like that you will set, you will have a counter example as well. So it's kind of difficult. There's the notion of seriousness that is very, a large part in the evaluation of a disease. Like if you have a very severe disease, it's not the same. That is, if you have some mild symptoms. So it's kind of difficult. So do you agree that it's difficult? Yes. Oui.
Yes, everybody agree.
Ah, perfect. It's not like me telling them what you say. It's nice. Okay, so it's not like you can have some rules. So what we will do first, it's actually we are playing the movie of what we did on these signals. So now. We will use signal processing tools in order to maybe represent them in another space that will help us to figure out different phenomena of interest. One interesting question is the notion of U-turn, that if we want to detect the U-turn, I agree that there's some standard deviation on the time signal that can help, but the U-turn, actually what a U-turn will do is break the regularity. That when you walk, you tend to have kind of periodic signal or maybe pseudo periodic, but then when you will perform the U-turn, then something will break. And in order to see this break in regularity, we will use Fourier analysis. It's very basic signal processing. So I'm sure that all of you are familiar with that. Are you familiar with that? Yes? Yes? So we will do a little bit of reminder on this topic, seeing the discrete Fourier transform, the autocorrelation function, and the spectrogram. And then you will have to apply this tool to this signal, and then you will see that you will look at them in a different way, and maybe in a more clever way. So basic tools for signal processing. I think it's going to be kind of fast because it's something that you already know. So what is a signal for us? It's going to be an array of value. Here we have univariate signals. So you have the sample number n. In Python, it starts at zero. You have the time series values, and you have the timestamps. That's what we call the time vector as well. So this is what we're going to process. And actually, if you want to see these signals, there are two main visions for that. The notion of time and the notion of signals is something that is known for a very, very long time. And the first vision is to look at that from a physical point of view. It's to say, okay, what we have, like the array, the NumPy array that you have, it corresponds to the discrete sampling of something that really happened, like a physical signal that was actually the movement of the foot, and we just sampled this, and we have this signals, this time series. So you will seek to retrieve some physical property of the original x, that is a function of the real variable t, by studying the time series that you have. It's like the first vision. The second vision is to say that actually what you have recorded is only one realization of a stochastic process, and actually a lot of different signals could have happened instead of this one, and then you have one realization, and you seek to find some property of your stochastic process by studying the time series that you have. And actually, in most cases, we merge the both approaches. That's what we call statistical signal processing. And the tool that I'm going to show you are actually derived from this. So we will see together three notions. So first of all, the discrete Fourier transform. So it's clear. Then we will see why we should not use the discrete Fourier transform for our signals by describing the notion of stationarity. I know that Nicolas talked with you about this notion, the notion of ergodicity and the notion of autocorrelation function that will help you in the tutorial. And then we will see the spectrogram that is actually the good way to represent the signal that you've seen. So most of the tools for signal processing are derived from Fourier analysis. The idea is to say that x as a function of n is actually the sampling. It's like you took x of t and you put and you take one. You took only one value for t equal to n times ts, or ts is the sampling period. We can define as well the sampling frequency, fs, which is 1 over ts. So we assume here that we have uniform sampling, because that's what we have in the signal that we are interested in. So the discrete Fourier transform, it's actually a projection of these original discrete signals into on a basis of exponential complex complex exponential function, and then what you're going to have it's a vector that has the same size of the original time series, and each value of the discrete Fourier transform is correspond to physical frequency that is equal to k times fs over n, where n is the length of the time series. And fs over n, it's the frequency resolution that gives you what frequency are visible on the discrete Fourier transform. With Nyquist theorem that you probably all know, you know that no physical frequency greater than fs over 2 can be recorded. It's called the Nyquist frequency. So you know that actually what you will have for k greater than n over 2, it's going to be like the replicate of the negative frequency. So why are we interested in the spectral analysis? Because here we have seen that for locomotion, there's a notion of regularity, a notion of periodicity. And so we know that this notion of periodicity is well seen when we look at the discrete Fourier transform. So in most cases, we plot the squared magnitude of the discrete Fourier transform, that it's sometimes called the spectrum of the signals, and we plot that as a function. Most of the time, we don't plot that as a function of k, but instead of the function of fk, which corresponds to the physical frequency. And by looking at the spectrum of the signal, you can see if it's composed of phenomenon with smooth variation or phenomenon with fast variations. So I put here an example of why is it useful. Here you have six different signals, and I put two classes of signals. And for instance, if you want to perform classification for these signals, if you look at the time value, it's not easy. Like the mean is the same, the standard deviation is the same, and actually by eye, it's very difficult to see that there are actually two classes of signals. But if you compute in their spectrum, then you can see that it was very clear that signal 1, 2, and 6 were the same, were generated in the same way, and signals 3, 4, and 5 were a different class. So actually, discrete Fourier transform, it's very useful. Sometimes when you don't see differences between signals in the time domain, you can switch them in the frequency domain, and you will see some phenomena that were not visible in the time domain. So we could do that for signals, but actually you cannot do that. It's forbidden. Why is it forbidden? Because there's a very important notion for these signals. Then we'll switch to the second vision, that is the statistical vision of our signals. The idea is to say, okay, I have an array of value, and that each value in my array is only one realization of a random phenomena. Actually, each x as a function of n is a realization of a random variable. And the idea is maybe by studying the property of my time series, I can access the property of the original statistical process that generated these signals. But if you want to do that, there are two fundamental properties that you need to use. First of all, is the notion of stationarity. So there's, I think that Nicolas told you about this notion. What does it mean that the time series or signal is stationary? It means that the statistical property of the time series do not change over time. So this is a very, very strong assumption. And in most cases, it's not validated. So in signal processing, we used a smaller assumption, which is the wide sense stationarity. What does it mean? It means that, for instance, we want that if we take all the random variable for each timestamp, we want them to all have the same statistical mean equal to mu here. So that is the order one stationarity. It means that the time series that you have should have a constant mean in the statistical sense. So this is a assumption that we will make that we'll have to make for our signals. The second assumption is the order two stationarity. It means that if you look at the correlation between any two points in your time series, then it will be a function on the differences between the samples, the time samples, the indexes of the samples in your time series. Meaning that, for instance, if you have a time series, the statistical link between sample 1 and 4 is the same that the statistical link between 2 and 5 and 3 and 6, etc. It only depends on the lag between the two samples that you are looking. This is the main assumption that we will make. And then when you have order one and order two, then you have the wide sense stationarity that is the most common assumption in signal processing. So that is something that is, if you want to apply statistical signal processing tools, you will need this assumption to be verified. The other important notion is the notion of ergodicity. This is a more complex notion that means that by studying your time series over time, it's the same than studying it statistically. Meaning, for instance, that if I study my own life, for instance, I had things happening to me in my life, I will say that studying only my life will be sufficient to understand the lives of every human being on Earth. Why is it so? Because if during my life I tend to live all experiences that a human being can make, then studying my life over time is equivalent to studying the life of other human being at a given point. So it's a difficult assumption that is actually already always assumed in signal processing, but that may be not that easy actually to be verified. So, for instance, I have two signals here. You have a signal that is so none of these signals are stationary. Why is it so? The first signals, you can see that there's a break in the average, so you cannot say that all the random variables here have the same statistical mean. So this signal is not stationary. For the second signal, here the mean it's the same, so it's that order one is okay, but order two is not okay. Because if you see the statistical link between two samples in the first regime, or one sample is in regime one and one in the regime two, or two samples in the regime two, all these links, the statistical links, are not the same. So it's not true that the correlation between two samples only depends on the lag between them. So you see that all these signals are not stationary. And you see why I say that? Because all the signals that we have seen on the gate analysis, they are not stationary as well. So what can we do to prevent that? Then there are two ways of doing that. The first way is to say, okay, this signal as such is not stationary. But if I take a small frame of 1 second, for instance, then this is stationary. Then if I take another frame, it's stationary, etc. That's the first way of processing non-stationary signals, is to take small frames, and we assume that on each frame the signal is stationary, and then reprocess this way. This is what we're going to do by introducing the spectrogram, which will be the extension of the discrete Fourier transform to this kind of non-stationary signals. The other way is to say, okay, I can first detect where there is a change, for instance, a change of mean in the first signal or a change in variance in the second signals. And I can use a dedicated algorithm for that. And then I will process the different regime independently, and they will be stationary. That's change point detection that you will experience later. So we have seen a very important quantity in the previous slide. It's this quantity. This quantity gives you the link between two different samples in your time series. And we have seen that it's only a function of the lag. So what we want to do is, by using the white sense stationary assumption and using the ergodicity as well, you can estimate this function, that is a function of the lag, that it's called the autocorrelation function, with this formula. And so when you will see the value of this function for a value m, it will give you the typical correlation between two samples that are spaced by this value of lag. So when we so it can be it's a very useful quantity to discover, for instance, the presence of periodic component. And someone told me earlier that there was something about regularity that was interesting in our time series. So maybe this autocorrelation function can be helpful to see that. So how do you use the autocorrelation function? If you have an original signal here, sample at 100 Hz, then you can plot you can plot the autocorrelation function. So the greatest value of the autocorrelation function will always be for lag equal to m. It means like you compare the time series to itself. And then here, for instance, you see that you have a local maximum for lag equal to 50. Why does it mean? It means that when you compare your time series and the same time series translated by 50 samples, then it kind of look alike. What does it suggest? That maybe there's in your signal something periodic with a period equal to 50 samples. And in fact, it was true. In my original signal here, it was a sinusoid plus some very large noise. And it was possible to detect that by looking at the autocorrelation function. So if you're searching for a notion of periodicity and to detect what is the period of signals, you can plot the autocorrelation function. And if you get a peak, you will know that there will be a periodic component in your signals. Okay, so now that we have seen that, we will see the notion of spectrogram that will be the tool that we are going to use to study our signals. What is a spectrogram? It's a way to apply some discrete Fourier transform on a non-stationary signals. So you will first take your signal, your original signal. You will take one frame here. You will compute the discrete Fourier transform, actually the squared magnitude of the Fourier transform, and we put that in a matrix. So at the end, you will have a time frequency representation, a matrix representation where each column corresponds to the discrete Fourier transform on the window of interest. So the x axis will be the frame number, you will get that, and the y axis will be the frequency bin. So I will show you how it can compute it. So here we have an original signal. You can see that it's not stationary. Then you take the first frame here, and you compute the discrete Fourier transform, and you put that in the first column of your matrix. So this is what you get. Here you have a representation where hot colors correspond to large value, and where cold colors correspond to small value. So you get this. So you put the first frame in your matrix. Then you do the same with the second frame. So you put that in the matrix, and etc. So here you have a frame where two phenomena are mixed, and you can see that on the spectrogram. You have two phenomena here, and then you can do that for the whole signals. And then, for instance, you can see that there was a sinusoid component at 100 Hz during the first regime and at 200 Hz in the second regime. So this is useful to see the discrete Fourier transform, but as a function of time. It's important that for non-stationary signal you use spectrogram instead of discrete Fourier transform, because discrete Fourier transform will tend to merge everything. So using a spectrogram can help you to keep the notion of time here. And so the best is always to see the spectrogram in order to see that it's stationary. And if the signal is stationary, then you can compute the discrete Fourier transform. An example on that: if you see these signals and if you plot its discrete Fourier transform, you might think that okay, there's a sinusoid around frequency 100 Hz present in here. But if you look at the spectrogram, you see that it was not the case at all. It was here a sharp signal where the fundamental frequency was evolving all the time. So here, you see that it's better to use, it was more clever to use the spectrogram instead of the discrete Fourier transform. Okay, so what are the parameters for this spectrogram? Then the first parameters is the window length. Most of the time we take a power of 2, and it will be, how will you choose this value? You want that to be small enough so that you can assume that you will have something that is stationary on each frame, but it needs to be large enough in order to get a good frequency resolution. So it's a compromise that you need to do. The second parameter is the N overlap. It's the overlap between two frames that you used for computing the spectrogram. In most time, you take 50% or 75%. In our case, we will use an overlap that is the window length minus 1, meaning that you compute that the discrete Fourier transform for each frame you move by one sample at the time. And the third parameters, it's the analysis window, and we want to use that. We will use the default version for signals. Okay, so I've spoken a lot. So now you will apply this notion of spectrogram for the signals that you have. So you will see on the notebook some function to compute the spectrogram. And here the idea is to use the different parameters so you can see what happens between LC and pathological subjects. For instance, you observe some lack of regularity for some subject. Does it apply in the does it shows on the spectrogram? And another thing that will be useful for us is to select the relevant frequency band. So we will see that the phenomenon of interest are located in a small frequency band that you will need to see. So I'll let you switch to the tutorial part, and you will see that you will have some questions to answer on the influence of the parameters, the distinction between the different phases, and finding the relevant frequency band. So I'll let you do this.
Okay, thank you very much. Maybe there is some question before the practical part. No, everything is okay? Yes? Okay. Okay, so everybody here is concentrated to begin the notebook.
Perfect. I have some interesting question here about the force parameters in the spectrogram function that you have seen. That I told you in my talk that the number of bin for the was equal to the frequency length, and I put in the function that the NFFT is equal to 4 times the window length. Why did I do that? I actually used something called zero padding. It's more advanced signal processing. It's a trick that if you add a lot of zero to your signals and then you compute the Fourier transform, you will get a better frequency resolution. So I actually did that because if for instance you take a small window equal to, for example, 2 seconds, so it's mean 256 samples, then since most of the frequency content of the signals is in a very small band, then you wouldn't have seen anything. So I just put a large number on NFFT so that the frequency resolution is better and so that you can really see the phenomenon of interest. But it's up to you. You can change that if you want. And so, yeah, actually, we put the signals. We put 3 times the same signal, but with only zeros. And then you compute the discrete Fourier transform. It's a trick that it's used a lot to improve the frequency resolution. Okay, so do you have some comments on what you've seen on the spectrograms?
So who here wants to comment the spectrograms? Except saying that they are not the same.
So maybe the first question is, have you seen the fact that like most of the energy is located in a frequency band? Have you seen that? And which could be the frequency band?
Okay, I try. 0 to 5 hertz, more or less.
0 to 5 hertz. Yes, it's true. It can go. It can go. So we have actually for subjects that have good gates, it's very periodic. So we have something periodic with harmonics that can go up to maybe 10 hertz. But it's true that most of the energy is located between 0 and 5 hertz. So for the remaining of the tutorial, you can use, I don't know, you can decide if you want 0 to 5 or 0 to 10 or something like that. You can use whatever you want. And as far as the window size.
So you also have some question in the chat.
Yes, so the more we choose a small window, the more we have information of a local point of view. That's true. And it's true that when you will use small windows, then you can see on the original signals that a step is around 0.7 seconds, maybe approximately 1 second a step. So if you think in with that, you know that if you have a window of 256 samples, then you will basically have 2 steps in your window. So it means that you will be able to look at some regularity, but at very, very small level. On the contrary, if you lose like 512 samples, then you can study the periodicity in a better way because you will really see the regularity because you will look at, for instance, five different steps. So it's really a matter of what you're interested in. If you lose very large window, then the precision that you will have on the estimation of the regularity will be better because you will look at large phenomenon. But it also means that in a frame, it's likely that you capture 2 regimes, for instance. So the estimation will be less good as well. So it's really a compromise. Once again here, I'm not sure if there is a right answer for this. What is true is that if you take power of 2, I think that the 2 good value could be either 256 or 512, because if you go greater than that or smaller than that, then you will get something that is meaningless. You can also see that, I will share my screen, but you will see that you have a very, well, the U-turn is actually kind of easy to look at, because here you have something where there's nothing. Then you have something that is very, very periodic. Here is for LC subject. Then you have a break in periodicity that you can see here, and then you have periodic again. And with that, you can see that you can easily detect the period of the locomotion, because here you have a very strong frequency around 1 hertz, for instance, in C. So it's exactly what I told you, that approximately one step has a duration of 1 hertz, of 1 second, meaning that you have something at 1 hertz. So by looking at the spectrogram, you can also estimate the notion of cadence, meaning the number of steps per second. So it's very something that can be interesting to understand this kind of signals. You can also look at differences between left and right if you want, and you will see some of already described phenomenon that appear on the spectrogram as well. Okay. So I think now is the coffee break. Do you have question on this?
You have question? No. Maybe after the coffee. Oh no, Clotilde. Okay. No, people say here that you are very clear, so they have no question until now. But maybe the hard part. The hard part is after the coffee break. No.
Okay. So we can do the coffee break, and then we will use. It's fun because we will detect breaks in the spectrogram as well with change point detection.
Oh, great. So thank you very much, Laurent.
Thank you.